Next question says, which variable does not derive a terminal string in grammar? Okay, terminal string. So terminal string, we have two type of strings in a grammar, that is terminal and non-terminal. Capital letters are non-terminals or variables, and small letters are known as terminals. So we will look at each and every symbol one by one. So let's look at the S. So S is driving AB, and A is driving A, B is driving B. So we can say S is driving AB. So definitely S is driving terminal symbol, that is AB. Okay, this is the terminal string in which we have all the terminals. So terminal string, S is driving terminal string, A is obviously driving the terminal string, A is driving A, B is also driving B. Now B tends to C, and C is not driving any terminal symbol. So we can say C is not driving any terminal symbols, because S driving AB, A is driving A, B is driving B, but C is not driving any terminal string. So answer to this question is C. Next question says, in Java, after executing the following code, what are the values of X, Y and Z variables? So we have three variables, X, Y and Z. X is not initialized, Y is initialized with 10, Z is initialized with 12, X equals to Y plus plus and Z plus Z plus plus. So X equals to, this is important to see, plus Z plus plus. If we look at these two statements, they are post increments. Okay, post increments, which means first they will be used and then they will be incremented. So value of y is initially 10 and the value of z is 12. So after executing this statement, we have taken the value of y and used in this expression. Okay, what we are doing is we are taking the values of y and z and using them in this expression. Expression is y plus 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 z plus plus. So we are first using the values of y and z in expression, and then we are incrementing the values. So x will become 10 plus 12. And after execution of these statements, these two values are modified by 11. And 12 becomes 13, like this. So X becomes 22, Y becomes 11, and Z becomes 13. So these are the answers for these variables, 22, 11, 13. So the answer to this question is D, 22, 11 and 13, because this is post increment. This question says, the broadcast address for IP address 172.16.0.0 with subnet mask 255.255.0.0 is what? So it is asking about the broadcast address. Okay, broadcast address means all the host bits are zeros, all the host bits are ones. For example, this IP address is from which class? This IP address is from class B. Okay, this address is from class B. Class B range is 128 to 191. This is the range of class B. So this address is from class B, and we know the format of class B. In class B, net ID is of 16 bits, in which first 2 bits are reserved as 10. And then these are the 16 bits. Host ID is also of 16 bits. Okay, host ID is also of 16 bits. So as you can see, these two are the net ID. Okay, these are net ID bits. These are the net ID bits and these are the host bits, because this is 8-bit, 8-bit, 8-bit and 8-bit. That's why this is 32-bit address. So 8-bit and 8-bit, these 16 bits are assigned for net ID. These 16 bits are for host ID. So when you want to find out the broadcast address of any class, what you can do is you can simply keep the host bit ones, all the host bits will become one, and when 8 bits become ones, they become 255 in decimal. So 172.16.255.255, this will be the broadcast address for this IP address. Okay, first what you need to do is you need to recognize the class, then you should be aware of the format of that class, then you should be aware of the number of bits in the host part. So make all host bits as one, and that will give you broadcast address, which means broadcast address is B, 172.16.255.255. If this address was class C address, then the answer will be this, but this address is not from class C. So the answer to this question is B, This question is from digital design and this is very simple question. In this we have this AND gate, OR gate and NOT gate. Okay, this is NOT gate. These are the NOT gates, which means this AND gate is applied with two inputs, X and Y. And this AND gate is applied with NOT of Y and NOT of X. Which means this will give, okay, these are the two inputs to this AND gate and output here will be XY. And this NOT of Y is applied to this AND gate and NOT of this X is applied to this AND gate, which means this will be X bar, Y bar, okay, X bar and Y bar. So now these two inputs will be OR, which means the output will be XY plus X bar, Y bar. This will be the simple output for this function F here at the output line. So XY plus X bar, Y bar. This question is saying the Hamming distance between the octets of 0xAA and 0x55. This 0x doesn't mean anything. This simply means that the number is hexadecimal. This represents hexadecimal. So if you have any hexadecimal number, they can be written like this AAH. If any number is written like this, this means this number is hexadecimal. If any number is written like this 0xAA, this means this is hexadecimal. These are the different representations of hexadecimal number like this. So all these are the representation for a hexadecimal number. So this is saying we have a number AA which is actually hexadecimal number. We have a number 55 which is actually hexadecimal number. So we have to find the Hamming distance. What we can do is to find the Hamming distance, we simply need to convert these two hexadecimal numbers into binary numbers and then we need to find out the XOR of those two binary numbers. So you will see the XOR. In XOR, after performing the XOR operation, we will have some ones. Okay. The number of ones in the result of XOR of these two will be the Hamming distance. For example, the binary of 11AA is, binary for AA is, A means 10 and the binary of 10 is 1010. A means 10, this means 1010. 55 means 0101, this is 5 and then 5, that is 0101. So when you try to find out the XOR operation, okay, for finding the Hamming distance, what we do is we take the XOR of those two numbers. So 0 XOR 1 is 1, 1 XOR 0 is 1, 0 XOR 1 is 1, 1 XOR 0 is 1, 0 XOR 1 is 1, 1 XOR 0 is 1, 0 XOR 1 is 1 and 1 XOR 0 is 1. So count the number of ones in the result. Number of ones in the result are 8. Okay. So Hamming distance between these two chords is 8. Hamming distance simply means that in how many bits they are differing. Okay. In how many bits they are differing. Hamming distance is used to detect the errors in networks or in hard disk also. When you read the data from hard disk, we check the Hamming distance between the data which we stored and between the data which we actually accessing from the disk, or you can say from in your data link layer, to detect the error we use Hamming distance. Okay, so this will be the Hamming distance between these two codes. The answer is 8. Next question is, consider a 32-bit machine where 4-level paging scheme is used. Okay, this is 4-level paging is used if the hit ratio to TLB is 98% and it takes 20 nanoseconds to search the TLB and 100 nanoseconds to access the main memory. What is effective memory access time? Okay, it is simply asking effective memory access time in nanoseconds. Okay, so in paging, if you have single level paging, let's say what is the formula for one level paging? How we do the one level paging? If you talk about the single level paging, see, in single level paging, we have a page table which is used to translate the virtual address to physical address. For example, CPU generates the virtual address, which is actually divided into two parts, that is page number and offset. We take the page number to page table and try to find the location of this page in the memory, in the main memory. This is my page table and these are the indexes. Index is actually page number. So number of entries in the page table is actually number of pages, equal to number of pages. So this is simply saying that page number 0 is stored in the memory frame number F1. This is saying this page number is stored in the memory frame 2. Page number 1 does not exist in the memory, the entry is empty like this. So we will take this frame number and convert the virtual address to physical address. So page table is used to convert virtual address to physical address. Physical address will be like this, frame number and offset. We will take this frame number and offset. Offset will be copied from here because the page size equals to frame size. Always remember, page size equals to frame size. That's why we take the same number of offset bits. Same number of bits required to represent a page size, and same number of bits are required to represent frame. So after taking this physical address, we can finally access the main memory. Okay. Why we are converting virtual address to physical address? The reason is simple. We have physical memory, and physical memory requires physical address. We can access physical memory only with physical address. This is my main memory. Okay. Main memory is divided into frames, and virtual memory is divided into pages. That's why CPU always generate the virtual address, and this virtual address is converted to physical address with the help of page table. Okay, this is my physical memory, or you can say main memory. So all the words like physical memory, main memory, or simply memory, or primary memory, all these words are same. They are same referring to RAM, that is your main memory. So this is my memory in which I have frame here. So I can finally access this frame, and this will be given to CPU. Okay. So this is how things work in terms of paging, but this is single level paging. In single level paging, we have only one level page table. So what is the meaning of TLB? Why we are using TLB? TLB is a small buffer, or you can say a small cache. This is known as translation look aside buffer. That is a small cache which is used to keep the page table. Okay, so we do not keep any we do not keep any data in the TLB. We simply keep only page table in the TLB. So when you want to convert virtual address to physical address, you will take this virtual address initially with for the TLB. Okay, you will take this virtual address to TLB, and when then TLB will help you to convert this virtual address to physical address. The process will be like this: CPU will generate virtual address, and this virtual address will be taken to TLB. This virtual address will be taken to TLB. So if there is a TLB hit, you can simply access the memory for the data. Okay, let's say there is a hit, the page for which you want to find the frame number is found in the TLB, then there is a hit. You can finally access the data in memory. So two things are happening in paging. First you are converting physical address, virtual address to physical address, then finally you are accessing the memory. So two things are happening. If there is a miss in TLB, what will happen in this case? If there is a miss in TLB, you have to search the address, the page table in the main memory. So in this case, main memory will be accessed twice. Okay, so if the page level is 2, if the paging level is 2, then what you need to do is you need to access memory twice. First accessing the page level 1, okay, then page table level 2, like this. If the number of levels are 4, then you have to access memory 4 times plus 1 time for accessing the data. So effective memory access time in case of single level page table will be like this: access time of TLB into hit ratio of TLB. Okay, access time of TLB into hit ratio of TLB plus access time of main memory. Okay, this looks like the cache memory formula, but this is different because in this formula what you need to do is you need to access the TLB, and then if data is found in the TLB, you need to access the memory for data. Okay, this is the first case when there is a hit in TLB, which means you can convert the physical address to virtual address to physical address from the TLB itself. So this is first case when the page table is found in TLB. Then second case is if the page table is not found in TLB. Okay, this formula is like this: hit ratio of TLB into access time of TLB and memory access time. Okay, so if there is a hit in cache in TLB, then you can simply access the memory for data. Okay, if data is not found in cache, which means there is a miss in the TLB, then what you need to do is you need to access the page table from memory and then bring this page table to cache, to TLB, and then access the main memory for data. So there is a two access, okay, two memory accesses in case of paging. So if the page level, if the level of the page paging is 1, then you are accessing memory twice. If the level is 4, then you have to access memory 5 times. Okay, 4 times for if there's a hit, there's a miss in the cache, then you have to access 4 levels of paging, which means you have to access memory 4 times to convert the virtual address to physical address, because these 4 levels are in the memory. Okay, if there's a miss in TLB, that means these 4 levels of paging are in main memory. So first four memory access will be for translation of address, then last access will be for accessing the main actual data. So the formula for 4-level paging will become like this. In case of 4-level paging, the formula will be like this: effective memory access time in nanoseconds for 4-level paging. 4-level paging. What we mean by 4-level paging? 4-level paging means we have a page table. This is level 4 page table. Okay, this is level 4 page table, which is actually each entry in this table is actually referring to the base address of each page table. This is keeping the base address of page tables. Okay, there are many page tables at the level 3. And this page table is actually keeping the base address of these page tables. Okay, base address. This base address from where this page table is starting. So all the entries are actually pointing to a page table. This is level 3. Level 3 page tables are actually pointing to level 2 page tables, which are actually page tables itself. They are also page tables. Okay, so they are keeping the base address of level 2 page tables. Level 3 page tables are keeping the base address. The entries in this page table is actually address, which is actually a base address of the next level page tables, like this. So all of these entries are pointing to some page tables. This is level 2 page table. Finally, at level page table, we have some page tables. This is first page table, which is actually storing the page table entry. They are storing the frame numbers, like this. So they are storing the frame numbers. All of them are pointing to page tables, which are keeping the page table entries, which are giving you frame number. Okay. So you have to access memory 4 times. First, you will access this page table. Then this will take you to one of these page tables. Then you will access this page table. Then one of these entries will take you to one page table at level 3. Then according to the level 3 entries, you will go to the level 1 page table. So level 1 page table will store actual page table entries. Finally, you can access data from memory. So four accesses this to access to convert the virtual address to physical address, and one access for accessing the frame number from the memory. So the formula will become like this: for 4-level page table, effective memory access time will become hit ratio of TLB. If there is a hit in TLB, then you can simply convert the virtual address to physical address from TLB and finally access the main memory. But if there is a miss in the TLB, then what you need to do is you need to access the main memory to convert virtual address to physical address. In main memory, we have 4 levels of paging, which means you have to access memory 4 times to convert the virtual address to physical address. So 100 memory access time is 100 nanoseconds. Okay, cache access time is nanosecond, like this. So you can simply say TM to access this page table. Then again, you will access this level plus TM. Then this will take you to one of these page tables. You have to access one of these page tables, which means you have to access memory one more time. Then access final page table, that is which is storing the entries. Take these entries to TLB, which means you have to access TLB now. And you will access the data from TLB itself. Okay, you will not access the page table from memory. First, what you will do is, if data is found in main memory, if page table is found in main memory, you will bring this page table to cache, that is TLB, and then you will access the page table from cache itself. After accessing the data from the page table from the cache, you will access the final data from main memory. Okay, so there will be 5 times memory accesses. And in this, it is given TLB hit ratio is 98%, which means HTLB becomes hit ratio of TLB is 0.98, and it takes 20 nanoseconds to search the TLB, which means TLB access time is 20 nanoseconds. And then memory access time is 100 nanoseconds. So if you apply the formula, it will be 0.98 TLB hit ratio into TLB access time plus main memory access time, plus if there is a miss, which means 1 minus 0.98, that will become 0.02 into 5 times memory access, which means 500, 5 into 100, memory access time is 100 and we are accessing memory 5 times, plus 20, that is TLB access time. So this will come out to be 0.98 into 120 plus 0.02 into 520, and this is 117.6 plus this is 10.4. okay, this is 10.4. if you multiply these two terms, this will be 10.4. so this will give us 4 plus 6 10, and then 7 plus 1 8, and 1 2 8 nanoseconds. So this will be the final answer for this question, that is answer B. Next question is from computer network, and this question says data is transmitted continuously at 2.048 MB per second rate for 10 hours. Okay, so we transferred the data continuously at this rate for 10 hours continuously and received 512 bit errors. What is the bit error rate? Okay, we have to find the bit error rate, which means in 10 hours, whatever data we sent, we found that 512 bits were in error. So first, what you need to find out, how many bits you sent in 10 hours. In 10 hours. Okay, so let's see. We have transferred, in 1 second, we have transferred 2.048 MB, megabits. Okay, in 1 second, we have transferred this much of bits. In 60 seconds, or you can say in 1 minute, we have transferred 2.048 into 60 megabits. In 1 hour, we have transferred 2.048 into 60 megabits. Okay, in 10 hours, we have sent 2.048 into 60 into 10 megabits. Or you can say this will become 2048, and these three zeros will be given to this, and this will become 6 into 6. Okay, so this much of megabits are sent in 10 hours. So we have sent this much of data in 10 hours, and out of this data which we sent in 10 hours, 512 bits are in error. So error rate is 512 out of 2048 into 36 into 10 to the power 6 bits. Out of this much of bits which we sent in 10 hours, 512 bits are in error. So we can find answer like this: 512 2048, this will become 4. Okay, so 1 by 4 into 36 into 10 to the power 6. Okay, so if you divide 1 by 4 into 36, the answer will be like this: 6.94 into 10 to the power minus 9. Okay, this will be the bit error rate, 6.94 into 10 to the power minus 9. This will give you 0.00694. Okay, divide by 10 to the power 6. So after taking the point to this direction, you will take 6.94 into 10 to the power minus 9. So the answer to this question is 6.9 into 10 to the power minus 9, or you can say exponential of 10 to the power minus 9. This question is from database management system, and this is from functional dependencies. This question says, in functional dependency, Armstrong inference rule refers to what? So Armstrong rules for functional dependencies, Armstrong gives us three rules. Okay, so first rule he gives is reflexive. Second, it gives is transitive. एंड देन थर्ड रूल इज ऑगमेंटेशन रूल. सो रिफ्रैक्सिव रूल सेज इफ यू हैव एनीथिंग लाइक दैट वाई इज अ सबसेट ऑफ एक्स देन यू कैन बाय बाय द रूल ऑफ रिफ्लेक्सिविटी यू कैन से एक्स इम्प्लाइज वाई. ओके इफ वाई इज सबसेट ऑफ एक्स सिंपली एक्स इम्प्लाइज वाई. फॉर एग्जाम्पल ए बी इम्प्लाइज बी इज ए रिफ्लेक्ट इज अकॉर्डिंग टू अ रिफ्लेक्सिव रूल इज अ फंक्शनल डिपेंडेंसी. और यू कैन से ए बी इम्प्लाइज ए इज ए रिफ्लेक्सिविटी रूल. सो ए बी इम्प्लाइज बी इज ओके ए बी इम्प्लाइज ए इज ओके. यू कैन एड दीज टू फंक्शनल डिपेंडेंसी अकॉर्डिंग टू रिफ्लेक्सिविटी. ट्रांजिटिव रूल सेज इफ एक्स इम्प्लाइज वाई एंड वाई इम्प्लाइज जेड देन बाय द रूल ऑफ ट्रांजिटिविटी यू कैन से एक्स इम्प्लाइज जेड. ओके फॉर एक्स यूनिक वैल्यूज वी हैव वाई यूनिक वैल्यूज. ओके एंड फॉर वाई यूनिक वैल्यूज वी हैव जेड यूनिक वैल्यूज. सो यू कैन सिंपली से एक्स एंड जेड विल ऑल्सो भी यूनिक. फॉर एवरी एक्स यूनिक वैल्यू यू विल हैव जेड यूनिक वैल्यूज. ऑगमेंटेशन सिंपली सेज इफ यू हैव एनी फंक्शनल डिपेंडेंसी लाइक दिस ए टेंस टू बी इफ यू एड एनी एट्रीब्यूट ऑन बोथ ऑफ साइड्स इट विल नॉट अफेक्ट दिस फंक्शनल डिपेंडेंसी इन एनी वे. यू कैन एड वन एट्रीब्यूट ऑन बोथ साइड्स. ओके दिस फंक्शनल डिपेंडेंसी विल बी सेम. सो वी हैव थ्री रूल्स अंडर आर्मस्ट्रॉन्ग इन्फेरेंस रिफ्लेक्सिव ट्रांजिटिव एंड ऑगमेंटेशन. दैट इज ट्रांजिटिव ऑगमेंटेशन एंड रिफ्लेक्सिव बी इज द राइट आंसर फॉर दिस क्वेश्चन. नंबर ऑफ चिप्स 128 इंटू 8 रैम नीडेड टू प्रोवाइड अ मेमोरी कैपेसिटी ऑफ 2048 बाइट्स. सो वट वी मीन बाय 128 बाय इंटू 8. ओके वट इज द मीनिंग ऑफ 128 इंटू 8. This simply means that we have 120 cells and cell size of each cell is 8 bits. Okay, so we have a memory in which we have 128 cells like this. Okay, so this is the meaning of 128 into 8. 0 to 127 we have cells, 128 cells, and the size of each cell is 8 bit. The size of each cell is 8 bit. So this 8 is giving the word size and this is giving number of cells. Okay, so how many such memories are required to construct a 2048 bytes memory? So this can be written as 2048 into 8. Okay, because 1 byte equals to 8 bits. And this can be said as 128 bytes. You can simply say this 128 bytes because each cell is of 8 bit. So how many 128 bytes memory are needed to construct 2048 bytes? Simply divide 2048 bytes divided by 128 byte, or you can say 2048 into 8 divided by 128 into 8. Both of them are fine. So how many required? 2 to the power 11 divided by 2 to the power 7, that is 2 to the power 4. So 16 such chips are required. 16 128 into 8 chips are required to construct a memory of capacity 2048 bytes. So answer to this question is D. Next question is, there are three processes in the ready queue. When the currently running process requests for IO, how many process switch takes place? Okay. So this is saying there are few processes in the ready queue. There are three processes in the ready queue and one process is running. Okay, one process is in running state. Okay, let's say P4 is in running state. Now what happens is this is connected to this, which means whenever CPU becomes free, one of the processes will come from ready queue and will be assigned CPU. So when the currently running process requests for IO, okay, now what happens is P4 goes for IO operation. Okay, this process P4 goes for IO operation, which means CPU becomes free. Now CPU is free, so we can switch one process from here, ready queue, to running. Okay, this is ready state. So what we will do is when CPU becomes available, we can schedule one of the processes in the ready queue to CPU. Okay, because we have single process, we have single processor. Okay, processor is only single and processes are three. So it will take only one switch because P3 will come for execution and P4 will go for IO operation. So now CPU will switch from P4 to P3. So there will be only one context switch in this case, that is A. Okay, because we will run only one process. So this question is saying let Tn be defined by T1 equals to 10, this is base case, and Tn plus 1 equals to 2n plus Tn for all integers n greater than equals to 1. Which of the following represents the order of growth of Tn as a function of C? So it is given that Tn plus 1 equals to 2n plus Tn. Okay, so this can be written as, what we can do is we can solve this question by substitution method. Okay, so we have different methods for solving the recurrence relations. We can solve this using recurrence substitution method, and according to substitution method this will become 2n plus, we will put the value of Tn, because Tn plus 1 equals to 2n plus Tn. If you take Tn, then Tn will become 2. Tn will become 2 into n minus 1 plus Tn minus 1. Okay, you can say like this, because Tn plus 1 equals to 2n plus Tn. Okay, this is nothing but Tn plus 1 minus 1. This is Tn plus 1 minus 1, that is n. This is Tn plus 1 minus 1. This is Tn. So you can put the value of Tn like this, plus 2 into n minus 1 plus Tn minus 1. Okay, now again you can put the value of Tn minus 1, because Tn is this, so Tn minus 1 will become like this, 2 into n minus 1 minus 1, that is n minus 2 plus Tn minus 2. So this will become 2n plus 2n minus 1 plus 2n minus 2 plus Tn minus 2. Like this you can put the values, and finally it will reach a position where we will have 2 into n plus, okay, this will become n minus 1, this will become n minus 2, like this we will reach till 1. Okay, and this will become T1. Okay, this will become T1. So this is nothing but the summation of first n numbers. Okay, first n numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4 till n. So you can see this is n minus 1. Okay, this is n minus 1, this is n minus 2, then n minus 3, n minus 4 till n minus n minus 1, that is 1. So it will become, the summation of first n numbers is n into n plus 1 by 2, plus the value of T1 is 10. It is given the value of T1 is 10. So you can say this will become 2 into n square plus n by 2. Okay. So this is nothing but n square plus n plus 10, which means order of n square. Okay, by substitution method you can solve such recurrence relations, and the answer will be C, that is n square. In DMA transfer scheme, the transfer scheme other than burst mode is what? So in DMA transfer we have two modes. When we are transferring data from disk to memory, we can transfer in two ways, either in burst mode. Okay, burst mode means you can transfer a complete block at once. Okay, what you will do is you will read a block from the memory, you will read a block from the hard disk and will transfer this complete block to memory at once. Okay, without any interrupt. So this is known as block transfer. In this we transfer the complete block, which means burst mode. And second is known as cycle stealing. Cycle stealing means first you will read the data from disk to buffer, and then what you will do is you will transfer byte by byte. One byte will be transferred from disk to memory, and then CPU will steal the cycle. CPU will execute some, CPU will use the bus, data bus, and then again DMA will use the data bus. The problem is we have a single data bus in our system, so that's why DMA is also required data bus to transfer data from memory to our IO devices, and CPU also required data bus. So that's why we use data cycle stealing mode, in which CPU and DMA alternate in the cycles. One cycle is used by DMA, and next cycle is used by CPU, then next cycle is used by DMA, then next cycle is used by DMA, CPU, like this. So they use in the alternate mode. So we have two modes in DMA transfer, that is burst mode and cycle stealing mode. So this is cycle stealing technique. Nth derivative of x to the power n is what? Which means if you do the differentiation of x to the power n n times, what will be the answer? Okay, if you have fx equals to x to the power n, it is given. What will be f dash x? f dash x is nothing but simply differentiation of this, so it will give nx, okay, n, then x to the power n minus 1. If you again differentiation this, it will give n into n minus 1, x to the power n minus 2. Okay, again if you differentiate this, it will give n into n minus 1 into n minus 2 into x to the power n minus 3. Like this, if you differentiate this n times, this will give you n into n minus 1 into n minus 2 into n minus 3, like this till 2 into 1, and this will become x to the power 0. Okay, x to the power 0. So this is nothing but n factorial. Okay, this is nothing but n factorial, n into n minus 1 into n minus 2 into n minus 3 till 2 1. So answer to this question is D. This question is from operating system, and this question says a total of 9 units of a resource type available and given the safe state shown below, which of the following sequence will be a safe state? Safe state means if you can satisfy the request of all the processes, then you can say this is a safe state and there is no deadlock. So process P1, the maximum requirement of process P1 is 7 and 2 are already allocated. P2 requires 6 resources to execute and 1 is allocated, like this P3 and P4. So we can say they are requesting, they have more request of how many resources. It requires 7 and 2 are allocated, so it requires 4 more resources. It is requiring 6 and 1 is allocated, that means 5. 5 minus 2 is 3 and 4 minus 1 is 3. And total available resources are 9. Total are 9 and we have already allocated out of 9, 3 plus 2, 5 and plus 1, 6. 6 are already allocated, so available resources at this state are 3. So with 3 resources, what you can do is you can start with satisfying the request. Let's say I am giving these 3 resources to P4. Okay, if I give these 3 resources to P4, this process P4 will start execution and will complete the execution. After using all the resources, it will release these resources, which means it will release 4 resources. Okay, after the completion of P4, we will have 4 resources. Okay, we will have 4 resources, and this with these 4 resources I can satisfy the requirement of this process P3, but I cannot satisfy the requirement of P1 or P2 because they require 5 more resources. So I can satisfy the request of P3. So P3 will be executed, and after execution it will release 5 resources. Okay, it will release 5 resources. With these 5 resources I can satisfy the request either of P1 or P2. So we have 2 safe sequences like this, P2, P1, and then P4, P3, P1, P2. So it will give 2 safe sequences, and either one of these can be used to execute the processes. So P4, P3, let's say P4, P3, P2, P1. So if I execute P3 first, then I can execute also. If I start with, okay, we do not have any sequence like this, P4, P3, P2, P1, so we can have more sequences. How? Let's say I do not execute P4 initially, I will start with P3. Okay, if I start with P3, what I can do is I will execute P3, and after the execution of P3, if I execute P3 initially, because I have available 3 resources and I can satisfy the request of P3 or P4. So let's say I satisfy the request of P3. So we will have 4 sequences according to this. Okay, 4 safe sequences. 2 are these and 2 are I will find out. So P3 is executed, and after the completion of execution, we will have 5 resources available. So with 5 resources, I can fill the requirement of P1 or P2. So let's say I am executing P1 first. So P3, P1, and then after the completion of P1, I can execute P4 or P2. So I can satisfy that it will release after the execution of P1, we will have 7 resources. Okay, after the execution of P1, we will have 7 resources. After the execution of P3, we will have 5 resources. So with these 5 resources, I have filled the requirement of P1. Now P1 will execute and will release all the resources, 7 resources. So with these 7 resources, I can fill the requirements of P4 or P2. So let's say I'm executing P2 and then P4. Okay, this can be a safe sequence. Or we can have one more safe sequence, that is P3. After P3, after the execution of P3, I can execute P2 also. So P2, P1, P4. Like this, we can have many safe sequences. So which of these is matching with our options? So if I execute P4 first, then I have to execute P3 then. Okay, because after execution P4, I will have only 5 resources available. After the execution of P4, I will have 4 resources. Okay, with 4 resources, I cannot fill the requirement of P1 or P2 because they require 5. So after P4, there can only be P3. So these 3 options are already eliminated because after P4, there will be P3. So this is the right answer, that is P3, P1, P2, P4. This is the safe sequence they are talking about. So D is the right answer for this question. This question is from probability and this is very simple question. They are saying 3 coins are tossed simultaneously. The probability that they will fall 2 heads and 1 tail. Okay. So if I toss 3 coins simultaneously, what will be the sample space? What will be the total possible outcomes? Okay, sample space. Sample space means it will contain all possible outcomes with 3 coins. With 3 coins, I can have like this. All 3s are head. Okay, 2 heads and tail on the third coin, or head tail head, head on first coin, tail hand, tail on second coin and head on third coin, or I can have head tail tail like this, then I can have tail head head, tail head tail, tail tail head, or tail tail tail. So I can have these 8 combinations with 3 coins. Okay, with 3 coins I can have these 8 combinations. Which of these are required cases? We want 2 heads and 1 tail. So 2 head, 1 tail, 2 head, 1 tail, 2 head, 1 tail, and then we have these 3 possible cases. So favorable cases means which are satisfying our condition, that is 2 heads and 1 tail. So favorable cases are head head tail, 2 head 1 tail, 2 head 1 tail, 2 head 1 tail. These 3 are the favorable cases. Probability is nothing but number of favorable cases divided by total cases. Okay, so number of total cases. So number of total cases are 8, and out of these 8 cases, 3 are favorable cases. So probability is 3/8. This is the right answer for this question. This question is saying the average depth of binary search tree. Okay, binary search tree. We are talking about binary search tree. So binary search tree says, what is the property of binary search tree? It says if we have a parent A, then left child should be less than or equals to A and right child should be greater than A. So this is the condition of this binary search tree. So we can have a binary search tree like this, 10, 8, 11. This is binary search tree because left hand side is less than the parent and right child is greater than the parent. This is the property of binary search tree. So in binary search tree, if you say best case depth will be when the binary search tree is completely balanced. Okay, balanced binary search tree means it is balanced on every level. For example, A B C. Okay, A B C can be anything values like this. This is best case binary search tree, which is balanced. Okay, if you talk about worst case binary search tree, worst depth of binary search tree can be like this when it is unbalanced. When the tree is unbalanced. Unbalanced means it is either left skewed like this or it is right skewed like this. Okay, we have only right childs or we have only left childs. So that if you can see the depth of this binary search tree is 4. And we have 4 nodes in this. So in worst case it will have order of n, in best case it will have order of log n. And the combination of balanced and unbalanced will be the average case. Average case will have a binary search tree in which we will have balanced nodes or unbalanced node also, both the combination of both these. So average case binary search tree depth of binary search tree in average case will be order of log n. This question is simple from C programming, and this question is saying we have a main program, and in this main we have defined a variable index. Index is used for the indexing in loop. Loop is running from index equals to 1 to 5, and this is printing the value of index. Then we are checking the value of index. If the value is 3, we will continue. Continue means if we have any statement after this continue statement, we will skip this set of statements and we'll jump to the next iteration of the loop. Okay, so this will actually, if continue is before this, if we have continue here, it will skip all these operations if the condition is true. But we have continue in last, so there's no benefit of continue because it will not skip anything. We do not have any statement after continue, so it will not skip anything. So program will run like this. Initially index value is 1, so 1 will be printed. Then we will check if index equals to 3, no. Then index will become 2, so it will print the value of index. Then it will check whether the value of index is 3, no. Again it will like take the value of index 3 and it will print 3. After printing the 3, okay, this is important. After printing the 3, it will check the value of index. Index equals to 3, true, yes. Then continue. Continue to next iteration. If it was break, the program will come out of the loop. Okay, program will come out of the loop. So this is continue. Continue simply skip all the statements after this continue statement in the current iteration. So next iteration it will print 4 and then it will print 5. So there is no benefit of continue at the last because continue will skip some statements which are after this. So if it is a last statement, there is no statement after this. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 will be the right answer for this question. That is B. This question is from software engineering and this is saying the cyclomatic complexity of the following control flow graph is what? So what we do is in software engineering, when we do the testing, in testing phase we have path testing. Okay, in testing phase we have a type of testing that is path testing. In path testing what we have is, and this is the part of white box testing, or you can say structural testing. Structural testing, what we can do is we can see the code and according to the code we can generate a control flow graph from the code. So this is simply saying A is a decision point, A is a if else statement. If condition is true, go to B. If condition is false, go to C. Okay, after C execute B, after B execute D, and after D go to B again. So this is a control flow graph of a program. So what we can do is we have a program because this is white box testing. So you are available program. Program is available to you, and according to program you can generate a control flow graph, and from control flow graph you can generate a DD path. DD path is nothing but what we do is we take the sequence of nodes, all those nodes which are in sequence, for example C and E are in sequence, we make them a single node. So from the independent path, what we do is from the DD path we find the independent path, number of independent paths. For example, in this case we can have independent paths like this, start from the starting point and reach the last point. This is the let's say this is last statement. Okay, this is last statement D. So we can have independent paths like this A, B, D. Okay, we have to reach A from A. Then A, C, E, D. A, C, E, D. Then we can have one more independent path, that is A, B, C, E, D. Okay, A, B, C, E, D. This can be the one more independent path. Can we have any more independent paths? A, B. We can have independent path like this. A, C, B, D. Okay. A, C, B, D. These will be the four independent paths in this graph. Okay. Number of independent path. And in every independent path you have to add a new edge, new vertex. Okay, new vertex should be added in every unique independent path. So number of unique independent path in this is 4. Okay, this is simply cyclomatic complexity. Cyclomatic complexity helps you to find the number of independent paths. If the cyclomatic complexity is 4, that means we have 4 independent paths in a graph. So if you can find the number of independent path, this means this will give you how many test cases should be executed to cover all the statements in a program. So let's say you have 1000 line in a code, 1000 lines in a program. So to test 1000 lines, what you need to do is how many test cases should be executed to test these 1000 lines. So number of independent path gives you that that information. If number of independent path is 4, which means you need 4 test cases to cover all the statements, So how it is related to cyclomatic complexity? Cyclomatic complexity is actually used to find the number of independent path. This is simple graph. This is the graph of 5 vertices. So you can simply find the number of independent path like this. So you can say cyclomatic complexity is 4. But if you have a graph in which you have thousands of vertices and edges, how you will find? You cannot count the number of independent paths in that. For that purpose, we use cyclomatic complexity. Cyclomatic complexity is same as finding the number of regions in a graph. Cyclomatic complexity, the formula for cyclomatic complexity is number of edges minus number of vertices plus 2. Okay, you can see this is the formula for finding number of regions in a graph. You have seen this in graph theory. So number of edges in this graph are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So we have equals to 7 edges, and number of nodes are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we have 5 nodes in this graph. So cyclomatic complexity will be 7 minus 5 plus 2. Okay, 7 minus 5 plus 2, which means 4. So cyclomatic complexity is of this graph is 4. Okay, you can check the answer from here also. This means cyclomatic complexity means we have 4 independent paths in this graph. Okay, and we have seen we have 4 independent graph, 4 independent paths in this graph. These are the 4 independent paths in this graph. So answer is right. So 4 is the right answer for this question. This question says which of the following algorithm design technique is used in merge sort? We know that merge sort is a sorting technique which uses divide and conquer approach. This is very simple. In merge sort, we divide the array in 2 parts according to the pivot element. We divide the array blindly in merge sort. We divide the array according to pivot element in the quick sort. So in merge sort, what we do is we divide the array in 2 parts recursively, and then we start combining them from the bottom. So divide and conquer approach is used in quick sort. This question is from Aptitude. This question is saying the arithmetic mean of attendance of 49 students of class A is 40% and that of 53 students of class B is 35%. Then the percentage of arithmetic mean of attendance of class A and class B. So what we mean by arithmetic mean? Arithmetic mean is simply the summation of all the numbers. Okay, summation of all the numbers divided by number of numbers. For example, what will be the arithmetic mean for these numbers? The arithmetic mean will be addition of all these numbers 1 plus 2 plus 3 plus 4 plus 5 divided by number of numbers 1 2 3 4 5. We have 5 numbers. So the arithmetic mean will be like this: 5 plus 4 9 3 12 4, 15 by 3 15 by 5, that is 3. 3 is the arithmetic mean of this set of numbers. So it is given that the arithmetic mean attendance of 49 students. The arithmetic mean, which is arithmetic mean of 49 students, is 40. Okay, you can say like this: arithmetic mean of 49 students is 40. Arithmetic mean is 40 and number of students are 49. Okay, so the summation of those numbers we need to find. Number of students are 40 into 49. You can say like this: number of students which are having summation of all those marks of summation of all those attendances, summation of attendances of 49 students is like this: 14 to 49. And summation of 50 attendance of 53 students is like this. The mean is 35% in this case. So 35 is arithmetic mean and number of students are 53. You have to find the summation of all the student attendance of all students in class B. Okay, summation of all the attendances in class B. So according to this, we can have summation of n equals to 14 to 49 and summation of m, that is all the summation of all attendances of class B, is 53 into 35. Okay, now you need to find out the Arithmetic mean combining these class A and class B students. Okay, so what is arithmetic mean? Arithmetic mean simply means summation of class A attendances plus summation of class B attendances divided by total number of students, that is A plus B. So we know that total number of students of class A and class B are 49 and 53. So 49 and 53. And we have already found out the summation of all the attendances in class A and class B. Okay, class A and class B. So you can find the summation by adding all these, that is 40 into 49 plus 53 into 35. Okay, so this will give you 37.4%. That is D is the right answer. This question is from theory of computation, and this is saying which of the following sentences can be generated by these two terminals. Okay, so what we can do is we can try with the options. Let's say can we generate BCC DD with this grammar? S tends to AS, BA, A tends to D and CA. So we have to start with B. So we will take this. We will take the starting symbol, and we will choose this production BA. So we'll start with BA because we want to start a string from B. So BA, then I want C. So how I can generate C from A? I can generate C from A like this, A to CA. So BCA, I have put it in place of A, CA. Again, I require one more C. So I can say BCCA. Okay, I have put it in place of A, CA, BCCA. Now in place, now I want two D's. Okay, but I can generate only a single D from A. I can generate only single D from A. Either I can generate D or I can generate CA. I don't need CA, but I have only one option D. So I can generate BCCD from this grammar, but I cannot generate BCCDD. So I can apply with this S tends to. I want ABBCCA. So I will choose this production S tends to AS. Then I want B. So I will choose this option. Okay, I will place as in place of S, I will place BA. So ABA. Now I want one more B. But if in place of A, from A you cannot generate B's. Okay, from A you cannot generate B's. So this is also false. ABC, ABC. Okay, S tends to AS. I have to start with A, so I'm taking this production AS. Then I want B, so I can say AS. I can say A in place of S, I can put BA. So now I want C, so in place of A, I can put ABCA. Now I want A, but from A, I cannot generate. From A, I cannot generate A, so this cannot be generated. So let's try with D option. S tends to AS. I want to start the string with A. Then S tends to, I want B. Okay, S tends to BA. So I can have A in place of S, I will place BA. Now next I want C. So I can generate C from A. That is, this will become ABCA. Okay, in place of A, I am putting CA. So now I want D. Okay, I have generated ABC. Now I want D. So D can be generated from A easily. So it will be ABCD. So I can generate ABCD from this grammar, but I cannot generate these three strings. So D is the right answer for this question. This question says comparisons required for an unsuccessful search of an element in a sequential search organized fixed length symbol table of length L. So we have a symbol table, and the length of the symbol table is L. Okay, symbol table is used in compiler design to store the variables and identifier, all these things. So this is the symbol table of length L. We have L entries in this symbol table. I want to search any variable in this symbol table. I want to search entry for a variable in this symbol table, and search is organized sequential. Okay, sequential search. So how many comparisons I need to make to search a variable in this symbol table? Okay, remember this is asking for unsuccessful search. Unsuccessful search means even if you search all the elements, you will not find the element. So you have to search each and every entry to find the element, and if it is not found, it is unsuccessful search. So you have to make L search, you have to make L comparisons without comparing any element. With all the elements, you cannot say whether this exists or not exist. So L comparisons will be required in this symbol table to find the, to say that a successful search is unsuccessful search. One sandwich has 24 ports. All 24 ports supports 8 Gbps fiber channel technology. What is the aggregate bandwidth of that sandwich? Okay, what is sandwich? Sandwich is nothing but a storage area network switch. Okay, storage area network switch. This is simple storage area switch, network switch, in which in storage area network we have all the database servers and storage devices connected together. So sometimes we use switch, and to connect all these storage devices we use SAN switch. Okay, SAN switch has 24 ports, and always remember SAN switch is a full duplex switch. You can transfer and receive at the same time. So you have 24 ports, and each port can transfer with the speed of 8 GB per second. So which means at one time you can transfer 24 × 8 = 192 GB per second. Okay, this is the meaning of aggregate bandwidth. Aggregate bandwidth means combining the bandwidth of all the ports together. If the switch is transferring from all ports together at one time, what will be the speed? Speed will be 192 GB per second. That is B. So find the output of the following Java code line. So we have a Java code. In this, floor is a method. This floor is a method of Java class, math class. Okay, we have a class math, and method is a method, or the floor is a method of this math class. So the floor value means the lower bound value. Lower value of 7.4 will be -8.0, because -8.0 is less than 7.4. -7.4, this is negative value. Okay, so in this, remember this is negative value. In negative, -8.0 is less than 7.4. In positive value, 8.0 is greater than 7.4. okay, so on the number lines you can see -1 is actually greater than -2, -2 is greater than -3, -3 is greater than -4, -4 is greater than -5, like this in the number line. So -8.0 is greater than 7, is less than 7.4. in floor value, what we take is lower value. So 8.0 will be the right answer, or -8 will be the right answer. Bellady anomaly means, so what is Bellady anomaly? Bellady anomaly is a problem which occurs in page replacement algorithms. In page, for example, we have page replacement algorithms like this: first in, first out, least recently used, most frequently used, optimal. So we have these algorithms, and these algorithms are used to find the number of page faults in case of different cases. So when memory is full and you want to bring a new page, you have to replace a page in main memory. So use these algorithms to replace a page. So if we allocate more number of frames to a process, then the page fault rate should decrease. But in case of some algorithms, there is a Bellady anomaly. Bellady anomaly means if you increase the number of page frames allocated to a process, in this case page fault increases. Okay, so the principle says if the number of page frames are allocated to a process, for example, let's say you have a process in which you have these pages. Okay, this process is accessing page number 1, 2, 1, 3, like this, and we have allocated 2 frames to this process. Okay, we have allocated 2 frames to this process, frame number 1, frame number 2. So how many page faults will be there in case of FIFO? 1 is page fault, 2 is field fault, and 1 is already there, not a page fault, and 3 will be a page fault. Okay, so this is the there will be 3 page faults if you increase the number of page frames. Okay, I'm increasing the number of page frames, let's say I'm increasing to 3. Now 1, 2, and let's say let's reverse the order of these two, 3, 1. Okay, I have replaced the order, and this will give 1, 2 is a page fault, and 3 will be here, and 1 will be a page fault. So if I have increased the page faults, even in this case number of page faults are 3, so page faults are not actually in decreasing. So this is known as Ballady anomaly, which occurs in FIFO, first in first out. In FIFO, sometimes it happens if you increase the number of page frames. Even if you increase the number of page frames, the page fault rate does not decrease, it increases. So A is saying Ballady anomaly means page fault rate is constant even on increasing the number of allocated frames. This is not the right answer. Page fault rate may increase on increasing the number of allocated frame. This is okay. Page fault rate may increase on decreasing the number of allocated frame. This is not a Ballady anomaly. This is normal. Page fault rate may decrease on, this is not a page fault, and this is not a correct definition. Page fault rate increases actually if you increase the number of allocated frames. So B is the right answer for this question. In an RS flip-flop, if the S line set line is set to high and R line reset line is set to low, then the state of the flip-flop is what? So we know that we have a table, excitation table of this SR flip-flop, and in this case output will be, if I apply 1 on the set state and 0 on the reset state, it will give 1. That means set, it will be set if we apply 1 on set and 0 on the reset. If I apply 1 on reset, it will be reset state. If I apply 0 on both of the lines, then it will be no change. And if I apply 1 1, it will be undetermined state. So this is saying if I apply 1 on set and 0 on reset, okay, what will be the output? Output will be 1, that is set to 1. In HTML, which of the following can be considered a container? Okay, container means which can contain more number of tags. Okay, these are the HTML tags. For example, HTML, it starts like this, HTML. Then we have head. Inside head tag we have title tag, and we give title to a page, let's say home. Then title close, then head close, and at this point body starts. In body we can have many tags. Body start, and we can do any work in body. For example, I can write a paragraph, a heading like this. Okay, this will be a HTML page, and I can write paragraphs, which means I can add a number of tags inside body. Okay, and I can add many number of tags. For example, paragraph 1 is welcome to home page. So this is a HTML page with paragraph and headings, and I can close body, and I have to close HTML tag. So this is a HTML page. In this, as you can see, and in any tag in which I can have more tags, more entities, that is container tag. Container means which can contain more number of tags. For example, HTML is a container tag, which because between HTML tags we have this much of definition. Body head is also a container tag. Okay, head is also a container tag. Title is not a container tag. We cannot have any more tags inside title. Okay, body is a container tag. Okay, we can have any number of tags inside body. So obviously select is a tag which is used to select one of the values from a top down menu or any other menu. So we cannot have any number of any tags inside this select. We can have any value inside select, but we cannot have any tag. Okay, so value is not a container tag. Input is simply not a container tag. Body is a container tag. This question says, in a system using single processor, a new process arrives at the rate of 6 processes per minute, and each such process requires 7 seconds of service time. What is the CPU utilization? Okay, so we have ready queue in which in 1 minute 6 process comes like this: P2, P3, P4, P5 and P6 in 1 minute, 0 to 60 seconds. Okay. In 1 minute, we have 6 processes in the ready queue, and each process is executing in CPU. We select one process from this ready queue and send it to CPU, and this process executes for how many seconds? 7 seconds. Then this process completes and new process comes to this CPU, and this spends 7 seconds. Like this, all the processes spend 7 seconds in the CPU. So burst time is 7 seconds. So we have 6 processes and each spending 7 seconds in the CPU, which means in 1 minute CPU is having 6 processes in the ready queue and they are executing for 7 into 6, that is for 42 seconds. Okay, 42 seconds. So next set of processes will come after 1 minute. Okay, so CPU will finish executing all these processes in 42 seconds because we have 6 processes and each process is taking 7 seconds. So CPU will complete the execution of all these processes in 12 seconds, in 42 seconds. And for remaining 18 seconds, it will have to wait for next set of processes because after 1 minute, 6 processes will come. So in 1 minute 42 seconds CPU is busy. So CPU utilization is total time and the time in which CPU is busy, CPU working. So CPU is working for 42 seconds and total time is 60 seconds. We are calculating for 60 seconds, that is 1 minute. So what percentage of CPU is busy? Okay, see, what is CPU utilization? So CPU utilization will be like this. This will become 7/10 × 100, that is 70%. 70% of the time CPU is busy, 30% of time CPU is idle. So is the right answer. Next question says, a symbol table of length 152 is processing 25 entries at any instant. What is the occupation density? Density is simply, we have a formula for occupation density and this is occupation density equals to number of entries divided by length of symbol table. Length of symbol table, number of entries are 25 and length of symbol table is 152. So this is nothing but 0.164. That is A is the right answer for this question. This is saying a problem whose language is recursion is called. This is simply asking about the recursive language. Okay, recursive language. And we know that recursive language are those languages which are decidable. Okay, recursive means decidable. So every recursive language is decidable, which means CPU will halt on all the inputs. It will say either accept or reject. It will say yes or no. So recursive language is a decidable language. That is D.